Mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sunship, Dizzy, and Billy Higgins, dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my jazz heroes. This is the Jake Feinberg Show.
Welcome, everybody, inside the Blackwood Broadcasting Studios at an undisclosed institute of higher learning. This is the Jake Feinberg Show, and we're happy you're all with us today. Everybody dreams. Some dreams are narcissistic and petty. Some have dreams so vivid that they almost seem real. Others dream and put those into reality. When you take the natural attributes that have been gifted to you, dedicate yourself to your craft, and dream for the stars, nothing can stop you. This mantra is not easy to establish. Self-doubt creeps in. Barriers, artificial or not, arise like a 100-year-old cactus in the desert. Remember, when you throw a T onto can, you get the word can't, which can prove to be the biggest detriment. My guest today vanquished his insecurities by diving head and shoulders into live entertainment. He was singing and dancing for opera companies in high school, all the while being encouraged by his parents. He played the saxophone and flute in the marching band, following in the same vein as Hadley Caliman, Sam Most, and James Moody. He took the T off can't and became a brother of invention. His career has seen him cross paths with Frank Zappa, George Duke, Jean-Luc Ponty, Roy Estrada, Chester Thompson, Ike Willis, and the Fowler Brothers. His stage antics and personality brought a new dynamic to the already independent and percussion-laden Zappa band. He sang about real people and real places, which allowed the audience to feel connected to the musicians. He has performed in R&B and gospel outfits and has put albums of his own, including the 2002 record Balls, which was an opportunity for my guest to strut his stuff to legions of younger fans who may not have been around for Bongo Fury. A great musician and an even better person, Napoleon Murphy Brock, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Thank you, Jake. Thanks for having me.
Could you talk a little bit about growing up in the South Bay and some of the experiences you had early on with music with your family?
Well, my grandparents that I was raised up with in Oakland, California, West Oakland, for the first 14 years of my life, they were a Baptist. And so we went to church 3 to 5 times a week. I was in each of the choirs, depending on what age I was. I was always in moving up to the next choir based on, you know, the, each person's age. During that time, I also sang in church, you know, every Sunday. And actually, when I was 5 years old, that was my first experience I share with you. I was actually up singing a song called Jesus When Trouble Burdens You Down. And I noticed that the older women in the front row were crying. And so I stopped singing and ran off stage to my grandmother, and I said, "Wow, Grandma, I'm doing something wrong." And she said, "No, honey, they're crying because they can feel what you're doing and that you touched them." And I never forgot that. And I always understood that, and even up until today, the importance of not just singing a song or performing it, but living within that moment with what you're doing, translating to the listener, and interpreting for that listener what you're feeling and what the song is all about. So I did that for 14 years of my life, and going into high school, I was in all the choirs. Also in high school, I sang for the dance band, and I was in the marching band, concert band, and I also was in the, all of the Broadway light opera performances that the high school did. I was then the choreographer. Her name was Marie Patterson. She used to choreograph for the San Jose Light Opera Company, and she saw me and told them that they should come and see me because I was a young and upcoming possibility. And as she put it, she says, he's a ham, you know. So, and basically what she was referring to was what I had learned since I was 5 years old, that you live the music, that it's a blessing, that it's not an accident. You fine-tune your craft, and then so you can interpret whatever you're experiencing while you're singing it, but then transfer that interpretation to the listener. And so I guess that was, in a Broadway production, I guess that would make me a ham, because I was really living it physically, you know, and I didn't hold back anything. Well, subsequently, the San Jose Light Opera Company came by and saw me, and they hired me while I was in high school to go and be a part of the San Jose Light Opera Company, and I was there for 5 years in about six different Broadway performances, Guys and Dolls, Damn Yankees, Oklahoma. We also did Carousel, and I can't remember the other two, but yeah, this is where I basically got my experience for stage, because there we didn't have microphones like they have today.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have headsets like they have today. This was back in the late 60s and the early 60s. And so we were taught to project to the last row. Everything that we did it to the last row of seats in the auditorium or in the theater. And so therefore I learned to project. For a while, my voice got stronger and stronger because I was taught to sing from my diaphragm and not from my throat. And in order to project to the last roll in the theater, it must come from your diaphragm, and this way you will be able to last through the entire performance. Your voice, I mean, will last through the entire performance and all the subsequent performances that will follow. But that's what I did, and that was basically what happened in my childhood, and then I started playing with local bands, you know, because music was in my blood.
I want to go back for a second. Can you talk about West Oakland, like the neighborhood and the community that you grew up in? Because what you're expressing to me is just the idea that you were, from a young age, very comfortable with who you were. And I think that younger generations especially are struggling learning who they really are. And I believe that it came from your family, and I believe that the church was very constructive. And I just want you to talk a little bit about West Oakland, the vibe.
Well, like I said, I was raised by my no-nonsense grandparents on my mother's side during that period of time in my life. And they were very disciplined-oriented couple. And we didn't talk back.
Right.
And it's nothing like the situation today. If we did something that was wrong, we did not only get spanked, but we had to go and pick our own peach tree switches that they used to spank us with. You see, we would have to go out and back and pick the switches off the trees. It would be a very detrimental experience that you would never repeat that act again.
Exactly, right.
They were strict disciplinarians, and I love them for that. And because I got a total perspective of what life was really all about. Because being in West Oakland, all around me, I mean, my first year of high school was at McClimate's in Oakland, and the police used to follow us home every day until all the crowds dissipated. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were fights all the time. I mean, girls would jump on you just as quick as boys. I mean, it was a rough neighborhood. And like I said, we were basically going to church a lot. And we weren't allowed to swear. We weren't allowed to sing the blues because we didn't, and my grandfather didn't believe in television. And so things we had to do, we had to read. We read the Bible, we read scripture, but we read other books as well. But most importantly, we had the security of being with our family. And my grandparents, they had three sons and two daughters, and three of the sons still lived at home, and so we had them to guide us as well, because one was a football star, and then he went into the Air Force, the other was a professional boxer, and then he went into the Army, and the other was You know, he also went into the army, so they were all military people. So, but basically what I'm saying, it was a very discipline-oriented family, and so our value system was not what was out on the other side of that door.
Mm-hmm.
Value system was what was inside the house, and the values that they taught and preached to us there. And these are the things we learned. We did not take advice from other kids at our schools, or kids that we would play with in the block, because we knew that the bottom line was that we had to go back home to Mama and Grandma and Grandpa, and if it wasn't the way they set it up, you were in trouble.
Yeah, I mean, it was, I only ask about it because I'm very fascinated with that region during that period of time. It was just, there was so much going on, and, you know, it's almost the amount of energy, negative or positive, was just so, it was so visceral, that you lived through that, you know, it's sort of, you grew out of that, just like George Duke grew out of Marin County before it was Marin County, you know.
Right.
It's sociological, sort of, introspection, but when did you, like, you also played the, in high school, you picked up the saxophone and the flute at that time? How did that happen?
Well, actually, I picked up the saxophone in high school as a sophomore and a junior, and that's when I started playing in the marching band, the concert band, and I started singing for the dance band because I loved, you know, Nat King Cole, Frank Sinatra, Bing Crosby, Dean Martin, and Johnny Mathis. Those are some of my favorite, and most of all, the person I loved most of all was Jesse Belvin. I mean, he was my greatest idol of all of them. And I didn't start the flute until I was in college, because I went to see a concert of Mongo Santa Maria. And I was at the Black Hawk. It was at the Black Hawk in San Francisco.
Right.
And I sat in the front row because I loved Mongo Santa Maria, and that album had just came out called Watermelon Man.
Oh, my gosh.
Loved the musicians on there, and I had to go and see, you know, what was going on, because what I heard on the album, you know, it was like more than Watermelon Man. It was far beyond that, you know, and the Afro-Cuban influence there was just, you know, it was just, I mean, it was hypnotic. It was just it was addictive. So I had to go and see for myself. And then I sat, and when the band came out and played, I got the greatest experience in my life, and I got to see and hear Hubert Laws in person.
You want to know something so funny? Is that not more than 3 hours ago, I interviewed Joe Sample. Who grew up with Hubert in the wards in Houston. So it's amazing you just bring up Hubert's name.
Listen, when I heard...
That's unbelievable.
When I heard Hubert Laws play the flute, I said, oh my God, I didn't know that that instrument could sound like that. And I had been listening to, you know, classical music, you know, while during my high school, you know, and during my college years. I love classical music, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Korsakoff, you know, Ravel, you know, Eric Satie, Beethoven, Bach. I mean, I love these guys. But mostly, you know, like Ravel and Debussy. Those were my favorite because, you know, and then Gustav Holst and the Planets. I mean, I was overcome by the beauty and the majesty of all of that, because it put me out into space, you know, in another place that I visited quite often, because I loved being beyond this earth, because I know that there's more. I know there's more out there than this. And so I was always reaching for that, and those classical composers, those that I mentioned, like Ravel and Debussy, those guys and Gustav Holst, they took me out there, you know. And so, but when I heard Hubert Laws, I said, oh my God. The next day, I went and bought myself a flute and taught myself how to play it.
Wow. So you were self-taught, your ear, you had great ear, amazing ear, you could hear everything.
Listen, I'm telling you, I sat at home and I taught myself how to play that flute, and because I knew that all reed instruments had basically the same fingering, and knowing that, you know, the flute, the oboe, they're all part of the reed family, and so there was no fear on my part of approaching it and making it a part of you know, one of my expressive instruments, an instrument that I could use. And so, and all my life, what I've tried to do is try, I mean, Ernie Watts is my favorite saxophone player, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Hubert Laws, hands down, the greatest flute player in the world as far as I'm concerned.
That's awesome. Wow, that's beautiful, man. Because I'm telling you, we were just talking about those Wards. He grew up with the Crusaders, and he went to the West Coast with them, but then he got kind of, he went off to Juilliard. But
yeah.
I guess that was prior to Juilliard. I don't know when that was, but that Afro-Cuban thing, Mongol was getting big. I don't think he had joined Cal at that point. Maybe he was on his own. It was after Cal Jader.
Uh-huh.
What an amazing, yeah, I mean, I think you, this is why I love having someone like Napoleon on the program, because, you know, you were demonstrable in all ways, prolific singer, dancer, actor, but yet you also just gravitated to the instruments. Most of the guys I talk to, they've only been expressing themselves through their instruments. So this is, it's fascinating to get this multi-sensory perspective, as opposed to someone like myself, who would be sitting there just aghast in a spiritual sort of days watching, you know, Mongol play those conga drums. I think that that was a spiritual experience for many youth, including yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I was into that, but by going there in person and seeing how they choreographed the music, I was able to see the contribution of that, because Hubert Laws played tenor sax too then.
In fact, he did. I, you know, when you, so you started, did you play in any, once you picked up the flute, did you play in like any of those Oakland band, those Oakland funk bands, the R&B, the soul bands, the Tower of Power type stuff?
Well, yeah. Well, see, this is what, like when Frank saw me, it was one of my own bands that that I had put together, and that I was playing flute and sax. That was my main instruments, flute and sax. And the other saxophone player, I actually had to go and buy him a flute and teach him and make him learn it, because he didn't realize the connection, and he looked at it as something more difficult than he could accomplish. And I explained to him, dude, if you play sax, you can play flute too, and I need another flute player, because we're going to play Thoris Genenopides by Eric Sarté. And I think, and they do it only with the melody, I hear the harmony. And I need you to play the melody the second time so I can play the harmony. Because, see, I'm a harmony freak. And my whole approach to saxophone and flute, the thing I love about Hubert Laws and Ernie Watts, I don't try to sound like either one of them. But they inspire me, and they teach me what's possible with the instrument. But my perspective on saxophone and flute, as I use it as one of my instruments, is this. It's an extension of my voice. I'm not trying to be, a Cannonball Adderley. I'm not trying to be Charlie Parker. I'm not trying to be Ernie Watts. I'm not trying to be Hubert Laws. I use all of those people to inspire me and to teach me what is possible on the instrument. But my whole approach to the instrument, the sax and the flute, both, they are two expressions of my voice, things that my voice maybe won't say, or I want to color them differently than I could do it with my voice. And I have many, many, I got three or four octaves. I got four octaves for sure, okay? And I can cover a lot of area, you know, with my voice. But I also found out that there's even more that can be said if you approach it as if that instrument was also, you know, an extension of your voice.
Mm. Wow.
That's very this hip. Is why I always play. When Frank saw me, this is what I was doing. I had a five-piece band, and we were in playing in the nightclub in Hawaii in Waikiki called the Red Noodle at the Coral Reef Hotel. As a matter of fact, I just released a live recording of that night, because I used to tape all the time. I used to tape a four-track TIAC, and I would tape all the time, take the set home and listen to it, and then play it for the musicians the next morning so we could make it better. Because there were only five of us, we had to all be multitasking to do a lot of the material that we did, okay? And so everybody had to do more than just one thing. If you played, you also had to sing. If you played two instruments, you had to play both instruments. Well, Frank Zappa came into that club, and he saw me. I didn't know who Frank Zappa was. But anyway, like I said, I just released the CD And the name of the CD is This Is What Frank Zappa Heard.
You know, and I want to know, was it Communication Plus? Was that the name of the band?
Communication Plus was the name of the band.
Please tell what the instruments were and what exactly you were. It sounds extremely dynamic. I'd love to know.
Well, here's the deal. The whole idea, number one, Communication Plus. That's the whole idea of the band, was built around its name. We are going to communicate with you plus. We're going to give you a live experience that you can take home and embrace and have it be part of you. We are going to make contact with you. You see, we are going to communicate to you what you came to hear and feel, plus even more. I play tenor sax, flute, and also keyboards and bongos, and I was the lead vocalist. The other saxophone player, who was basically mainly a keyboard player, he played keyboards, clavinet, and Farfisa Professional. Remember that organ that Sly Stone made famous, the Farfisa Professional? We had one of those. We put a small stone phase shifter on it and a wah-wah pedal, and that sucker had a patch on it that had a Leslie patch on it that was incredible. Okay? So he played the organ, the Farfisa, and the clavinet, and alto saxophone, and flute, okay? And he sang background, and he sang some duets with me. The drummer, he sang most of the duets with me, and he was a drummer, and he was a singer, you know, and most drummers, you don't see them singing while they're playing drums, because that's quite difficult, but this guy was great at that. His name was John McDermott. The bass player, he used to be my roommate, and I told him, listen, in order to be in this band, you're going to have to study other people than the people you hear, like the Rolling Stones and everything. And so I made him study Chuck Rainey.
Oh, that's a great call.
I gave him I need a bass player that can be a singer's bass player. I don't need you to just play the root. I need you to play the relatives. Okay, so because I hear it all, because I'm a harmony freak. I hear all the harmony parts. I mean, Frank was blowing his mind how many harmony parts I could hear that he didn't hear, and he would just ask me in the studio, "Well, do you hear another one?" And I says, "Yeah." He said, "Okay, we'll do it." You know, and then he was blown away because he said, "Wow, that's great. It fits. It works." But anyway, the bass player, he was a background singer, but he studied Chuck Rainey and other musicians that were on the CTI label. I turned him on to all this. I said, this is what you need to listen to. Playing the James Brown, playing all this other stuff, you won't have a problem with it if you listen to these guys, because they cover the entire spectrum. And then that was the guitar player. His name was Joe Sanchez from Houston, Texas.
Mm.
Hey, dude, Joe Sanchez, he could make some chords that most people would have to use the piano to make these voices and to make these chords. But he could make it with one. He had the longest fingers I had ever seen in my life. And he was playing his ass off. And like I said, Frank listened to us for a couple of hours and had his road manager come up to me and say, this guy wants to meet you. I says, well, who is he? He says, Frank Zappa. I said, okay, who's Frank Zappa? He says, you don't know who Frank Zappa is? I said, okay, excuse me, no, I don't know who Frank Zappa is. And I said, is he a musician? And he says, well, yeah, why don't you just come over and meet him? I says, well, what is it all about? I says, because I'm really kind of busy. Actually, there were some beautiful Hawaiian girls sitting in the front row. That's what I wanted to do.
Of course.
Yeah. So I said, and I looked over, I said, well, where is he? And he pointed him out in the back of the room, because the place was packed every night. And this was a Wednesday night. And I said, you know, he really looks familiar. He looks like a guy that I saw on a poster in Haight-Ashbury sitting on a toilet flipping the bird. I said, is that him? And he says, yeah. I said, well, what the hell does he want with me, dude? That's not a very hip resume, you know, to take your picture and put it on a poster sitting on a toilet. And then I said, dude, just come and meet him. You never know. And I says, okay. So I went and met him, and he put his hand down and said, oh, hello, my name is Frank Zappa, and you're my new lead vocalist. And I went like, well, my name is Napoleon Murphy Brock, and maybe you didn't notice, but I already have a job. This is my band. I put this band together. This is me. And so he says, well, that's not your real name, is it? And I said, well, no. It's as much my real name as if Frank Zappa is your real name and Napoleon Murphy Brock is my real name, why wouldn't it be my real name? He says, because it's too perfect. He says, it's just perfect. Listen, he says, I want you to come and go on the road with me. We're going to Europe next week, and you're ready. He says, all you have to do is, I want you to do everything that I saw you do. He said, I just want you to do it to my music. I says, listen, I've never heard your music before. Do you actually record? Do you have records out? Really? Well, why haven't I heard you on the radio? He says, well, my music is a little bit controversial. I said, well, yeah, but I never heard your music. What do you mean, you know, you want me to go on tour with you next week and to sing your music? Music I've never heard before. I says, this is impossible. I says, I make these guys practice 4 days a week. I says, and you're going to, he said, well, I'll fly in Monday and teach you everything you need to know to do the whole tour. I says, dude, that's not possible. I mean, I'm a very disciplined person, you know. You can't teach me in one. I says, you know, no, the answer is no. The answer is no. I appreciate the compliment and everything.
Wow.
The answer is no.
Wow.
And as I was walking away, I stopped and turned around. I says, by the way, you have a band, right? He says, yeah. I said, well, who's in your band? And he says, well, George Duke, Jean-Luc Ponty. I said, stop. Who? George Duke and Jean-Luc Ponty. I said, George Duke, the keyboard player from Cannonball Adderley, and Jean-Luc Ponty, the French violinist, they're in your band? And he says, yeah. I said, well, damn, you must be good. Because, I mean, my friends and I, when we were in college, we weren't old enough to be out. They had some strict curfew laws here. We used to go to the Salvation Army and get old clothes, and then we'd get Maybelline eye makeup and grow and make mustaches and sideburns, and we'd drink cheap wine and go down to San Francisco after hours to watch George Duke at the Blue Note.
At the time, was he at the Half Note? Where was he playing?
Half Note, I mean the Half Note. Yeah,
so he was playing with like John Hurd, Pete Magadini, and those guys.
Right, and then occasionally he would be there with Al Jarreau.
Al Jarreau, of course. No, I mean that's that.
He was our idol. Me and my musician friends, everybody in this band, but mostly, I mean, we would go down there. We would go through all of that just so we would look older. So they would let us in because it was 3 o'clock in the morning, and we weren't supposed to even be in the street then because of the curfew laws of that during that time. But we would go through all of that just to go and experience live George Duke. Okay.
My question is that, you know, because the way you describe it, and I'm glad we captured that. You know, it comes across almost like out of a movie.
Absolutely.
It's almost like
my mind when he says,
there's no reason why you should have even ever turned around. And then you asked him, and it happened. And it wasn't. He didn't advertise it. I mean, some people would. If you were playing hardball, he would have said, "Well, you know, I have George Duke in my bed." I mean, he could have said that stuff, but he didn't. You know, he just was asking you. It's unbelievable, really.
Well, he was focused on me doing what he saw me doing, and what I did then, and what I did in his band, and I did the same thing when George asked me to join his band when he put out Reach for it. Okay, I was an interpreter. That was what I believed in from the very beginning. I said, people, you have to interpret the music for the audience with choreography and everything. And I've got that information. I got that training from working with the San Jose Light Opera Company. You must live the music while you're doing it. Well, if you don't live it, why are you doing it? You know, I live it. Every time I go on stage, it's an experience for me that's astronomical. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you know, it's an out-of-body experience, you know? But it's controlled because I want the people who are listening and watching to feel that everything is being done in inclusive.
Can you talk, actually, this is a class, this popped into my head. So you actually didn't, you went on, Zappa went on tour, Frank went on tour, and then came back, and then you wound up going, what were those first couple of rehearsals like?
Well, what happened was that I said, wow, I said, well, this is a color of a different horse. You know, I always said things backwards like that, instead of a horse of a different color.
Yeah, right.
I always turn it around, so this is a color of a different horse. Anybody can say this is a horse of a different color. I think I'll say this is a color of a different horse. Okay? And so I said, here's my card. When you come back, give me a call and I'll come down and listen to your band. And maybe we'll pursue this. I said, but I'm not going now. He said, well, I'll buy the contract. I said, you can't buy the contract because it's a verbal agreement between me and the Samoans and the guy that owns this club, and his name is Claude Hall. He was the first Marlboro man that you saw on all those posters, all those billboards, the Marlboro man. This guy was the first Marlboro man.
Wow.
Okay. So anyway, I gave him my card, and I said, call me. As soon as I got a call about a month and a half later, and he said, hi, this is Frank Zappa. I said, well, how you doing? He says, how soon can you get down here? I says, I thought you were just coming back today. He says, I did. I just got off the plane. I'm at the airport. I says, yeah, but I meant call me after you go home and see your family and everything. I didn't mean call me from the airport. And he said, well, can you be here tonight or tomorrow? I says, well, no, I'll be there Monday. So I went down Monday, went in, and he had the whole band on stage, Ruth Underwood, Ralph Humphrey, Bruce Fowler, Tom Fowler, George Duke, and himself. They played five songs together that had at least seven to nine time signatures. Blew my mind. I said, oh, my God, someone has finally did it.
This is
rock opera.
Right.
I says, but he's using every musical genre that exists. I said, this is so cool. I says, now I know why he wants me in the band. I says, because this band has everything except one thing. It needs someone to interpret that stuff. I says, this is my destiny. I looked at God. I looked up into the air, and I pointed my finger in heaven and says, boy, you God, this is your doing. Because this is, I mean, it was my destiny, and I knew it right then. I said, this band, all it needs is me. And now I knew why he wanted me, why he said to me, I want you to do exactly what I saw you do. Just do it to my music. Because what I was doing, I was interpreting. And when we played James Brown, I interpreted the music to where the people knew it was funk. And they knew it was happening. And they knew it was James Brown, you know, because James Brown is the ultimate funkster. He's the godfather of soul. I mean, you know, when we played Carole King, it was Carole King, but it was Carole King being with her song being sang by in the style of Nat King Cole or Frank Sinatra or Johnny Mathis or Jesse Belvin. And then when we did, you know, Shaft, five of us, we played Shaft. I mean, there's no way, and none of the parts of Shaft, and that was a 19-piece orchestra that Isaac Hayes used to do that. All the parts were covered. All the important parts were covered because the song was interpreted properly by the five musicians I had there. The keyboard player, the other saxophone player, he played keyboards and flute and sax. I played sax, flute, and I sang the words and stuff. And when Frank heard what I did, I changed the words in Shaft. And this is how he knew that songs like I'm the Slime would not disturb me, or Watch Out Where the Huskies Go and Don't You Eat That Yellow Snow. And this is how he knew also that he could be able to compose songs like Cheapness, Pygmy Twilight, you know, and have me sing Oh No, I Don't Believe It and Son of Orange County. He knew that he could do all of that, and it was possible he had found the person who could interpret it and deliver it the way it should be done based on the value of the composition. But all that information that he heard me do that night on stage doing top 40 songs.
Well, we got a fired up Napoleon Murphy Brock, and I got a clip of music that I've been just rocking at, and I think it epitomizes the reason why Frank put you in the band. So let's take a listen and come back, okay?
No problem.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. Does anybody here know where Palmdale is?
Yeah.
You do? Good. Have you ever heard of a place called Sun Village?
Yeah.
Some of you know where Sun Village is. Oh, it's out in back of Palmdale. All right. At one time, that used to be a big place for raising turkeys. And I went to high school in Lancaster, which is not far from Palmdale. Oh, is it very good for other things out there now? Good. Can't turn me up so they can hear what I'm saying. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a song about this place where I used to live, where they used to raise turkeys.
Lot to go through on that, but just that was that was the reason Napoleon Murphy Brock was brought in by Frank Zappa.
Yeah, absolutely. Because he saw me multitasking, and he actually saw me, and it's also there's evidence because it's on the CD. It's apparent because there's only two or three guys singing. I mean, I used to sing in lead and background on the same song.
My belief is, and this is not, I'm not even close to a Zappa aficionado compared to some people I know, but I think he saw in you another personality, an overt personality that was different from just sort of the, he wanted guys who were going to be flamboyant, who were going to be out there, who were going to basically be, you were going to, you know, communicate, not, you were going to reach in and pull that person's emotions out of them.
Yes, absolutely.
So, and in many ways, I mean, you look at, there's plenty of video footage and there's pictures, you know, all this stuff, and the musicians are having a ball, but he wanted a, disciplinarian. He also wanted an actor, you know, and just some of the hooks in that song too. I think so, you brought some of those elements from that Communication Plus band and you tightened up some of those songs and maybe gave them a little bit more of a commercial appeal because you guys went commercial pretty soon after that.
Absolutely. And the thing about it is that, you know, he knew it was the right thing to do and the right time to do it with the personnel that he had assembled then. I mean, Chester Thompson came in the next day after I arrived, you know, and we were given the same musical charts. I mean, we had to hold out both hands, arms, to have all these charts on, you know, and then carry them to our car and put them in a box. I mean, that was how much stuff there was. But, you know, like in like Village of the Sun, I mean, I sang that live at the Roxy, but then we went in the studio and I doubled my voice. And then I started singing all the harmony parts. And he's just going like, can you hear another harmony? And I said, sure. And he was just, you know, blown away that, you know, I could hook up each harmony part with the parts that I already, you know, I'd already laid down the tracks for. And a lot of people, and you know, I hear all the time, these programs like American Idol and The X Factor and America's Got Talent and everything, and you hear these people that are kind of pitchy. They call it pitchy. Well, here's the problem with singers being pitchy. They don't practice harmony. If you practice harmony, then you eliminate the pitchiness.
You just opened up a whole other angle here to this whole thing. I just, you know, the other thing I wanted to, first of all, I would have loved to have been on that tour with Frank right before he came back. He was jonesing to get you
George.
And Chester into the band.
Yeah.
I mean, that tour must have been the most, like, he must have been going through the motions. He got back that day. He's like, yo, can you be over there that night? You're like, I got to wait till Monday.
Airport.
He's freaking out.
He's
jonesing, man. Yeah, I get it. No, it's there.
Yeah, from seeing and hearing Communication Plus and watching I was doing, and everything I did was to encourage the other guys in the band to go for it too. So I had to go for it. Every night, every song, I had to go for it. I had to live that piece of music as I was performing it, because then that transmits to them, this is how it's done. You see what I'm saying? And this is the result of it. You have to give 300%. 100% is not good enough. Anybody can do that.
Right, and he needed another. He was right in the pocket. The other thing I wanted to say, I just want to talk about this from an entertainment standpoint and how sort of removed we've gotten in my mind.
Oh yeah.
You know, this idea where the reason I opened it up with him talking to the crowd, the preamble is just he's talking about Palmdale. Okay, so it's a local concert. Here it is. This guy's he was not really ever. He was always anti sort of corporate or commercial, but he's a big name musician. He's talked to these people. The lyrics are the Village Inn and Barbecue, the turkey farms. These are all things regular people can relate to.
Yeah, and I could relate to them too. And the thing about it is that he knew when he wrote the lyrics, and he gave me the song to sing. He knew that I could relate to it too.
Exactly.
From my background, and so therefore it's easier to live something if you're familiar with what you're singing about.
Well, isn't that the whole point? I mean, Napoleon, that's what I mean. Like, you grew up in the church. You grew up in some ways seeing what the blues really was. I mean, you guys lived that.
Absolutely.
You know, so it's much easier to have authentic kind of authentic music when you've actually lived those lifestyles. And,
that's right. Absolutely. And got to respect them at the highest level, because we got to see, I mean, when I was living in San Jose, California. When I left Oakland, I came down to San Jose, California, and went to San Jose High and San Jose City College. But we would go to the Civic Auditorium. We would see Jimmy Reed. We would see B.B. King. Mm-hmm. We'd see Ray Charles. we would see the James Brown and the Famous Flames. I mean, we Hank Ballard. I mean, we would see, and at that time, when Ray Charles would come through, he had David Fathead Newman on tenor sax. He had Hank Crawford on alto. I mean, he had Hogg, this guy named Hogg, on baritone. I mean, we were blowing our minds, man, because these guys were so authentic in their execution of, you know, of the delivery of the blues, of jazz, of feeling. I mean, Ray Charles, if you didn't have feeling, you weren't in his band.
Exactly. And the other component to it, and this plays out when you guys are putting on the black makeup going to see George at the Half Note. It's like the size of the venues to be able to really be that close to Napoleon, Murphy, Brockwell. I interviewed Bill Cosby, and Cosby's talking about, you know, the sweat dripping off of Dinah Washington into his glass of Coke.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, you've played these rock palaces. You've seen the transition full form, you know, going from this sort of intimate halls where you can see Ray Charles, see the wrinkles on his face, see Fathead Newman really up close. And then all of a sudden you're playing these palaces where you're much farther away, and it hurts that intimacy. I have to believe that.
Well, it does hurt that intimacy, but the thing about it, and see, when I first went on the first tour with Frank in late 73, the first show, we get up there and we start doing the song, and then all of a sudden he looks at me and says, "Go." And I says, "What do you mean, go?" He says, "Just go out there and do your thing." And I'm saying, "Do what?" He says, "Just do what you do."
Wow.
And I got it. I went like, "Oh, okay. Well, okay then. You know, well, why not?" Yeah. So I went out there, and I'm dancing and everything out there, you know, and ad-libbing and making up all this stuff that's relative to the content of the song that we're doing at that time. And I could ad-lib. You just give me a subject, whatever subject. I'd ad-lib all the time. I mean, George Duke and I and Frank, we made up a couple of songs, you know. I mean, it's just incredible. Like, if you've ever seen the Dub Room special, have you ever seen that?
No, I've not.
Or The Token of My Extreme?
Yes.
Well, that's the one. It's also on a live album called Live in Helsinki.
Right.
Okay, and it's called Room Service. And we used to do this skit every night at every show, and every night it was different. But we ad-libbed it, and it was as if we had planned it, because Frank and I were that connected. We both knew. Both of us knew what Duke Ellington said. There's only two kinds of music, good and bad.
Right. I've heard that quite a bit. We're talking to Napoleon, Murphy, Brock, and I wanted to capture sort of, again, you just teed it up, a live show from when you first joined the band. So let's take a listen to this and come back.
Sure.
This is the sad but true story of how we wound up getting a record on the radio. You see, there's this guy here in Pittsburgh from 13Q, see? Uh-oh. Well, do you want to hear the story or not? Here's the story.
Come here.
See this guy here? Dennis is his name. Say hi, Dennis.
Hi, Dennis.
Clever. Dennis. Now listen carefully. History here. See, Dennis one day got a hold of the Apostrophe album, and he says, "I wonder what would happen if Yellow Snow was short enough to play on the radio." So he took it upon himself to cut it down to make it playable on AM radio. Oh, tut tut. Then, as if by magic, when he put it on the AM radio station, some children liked it and called up. The AM audience said, "Hey, hot." And so suddenly the record started going up, up, up the charts, and other radio stations started playing it. And the next thing we knew, we had a pseudo-bogus hit single on our hands, and it's all his fault. So take a bow, Dennis. Now go back there and hide before they get you, Dennis. And here it is. Was an Eskimo. Frozen wind began to blow. Under my boots and around my toes. Frost had bared the ground below. Was 100 degrees below zero.
$11,674, Pittsburgh Civic Center, The Yellow Snow, classic. So, the kind of buildup there is just is remarkable, especially with George playing that lounge keyboard in the background.
Yeah. but we had fun. It wasn't work.
No.
We rehearsed, 5 days a week. And, like 8 to 10 hours a day. We'd start at noon and go to 5, take 1 hour break, and then we'd come back at 6 and rehearse till 11, And then after we learned all the music and then memorized all the music, and then he'd come back with choreography and a whole bunch of other little pieces that he wrote out that he would give us signals for. And then maybe like 3 or 4 bars of music. And he would say, okay, here, when I give this signal, lift up my hair on the right side and give the downbeat. No matter where you are, no matter what you're playing, play these 4 bars and then go back to where you were. Even though the time signature of these 4 bars might be different than the time signature of that you're playing when you stop to play this. Yeah. And he had about 10 or 12 of those signals, and each one had a different 4 bars of music that we had to play and slip it in wherever we were, and then go back to where we were before with and articulate. It had to be perfect. Imperfection was not acceptable. Mistakes were not acceptable. Not knowing your part was not acceptable. Not doing the choreography was not acceptable. He was a strict disciplinarian. He made us better than what we are, but he hired us, and he had us there because we were the best that he could find to do what he wanted to be done. And he knew that. And so we were like going to a very select music conservatory called the Conservatory of Frank Zappa. He respected us for what we had already accomplished, and this is why he composed music around us that was us already. He allowed us to be ourselves. He composed music. When he composed Inca Roads, that's George Duke. That's George Duke. It was composed by Frank Zappa, but no one can do Inca Roads like George Duke because it was composed based on his existence on this planet and everything that everything that is him. That's what that song is composed of. The same thing with Village of the Sun, Pygmy Twilight, Cheapness. The Illinois Intima Bandit. I mean, the Illinois Intima Bandit. Him and I did that up in his hotel room after we saw the news broadcast down in the dining room.
What would he be able to figure out? And what would he say? Hey, Nappy, I need you to help me with this. What was he constantly relying on you for? Was it lyrics? Was it harmony? Talk about that.
Interpretation. He relied upon me to interpret. he knew that I had, when we did the Evil Prince, he had seen me use my opera voice, quote unquote, you know, in different songs, because I sang all these different styles in different songs, whatever the song required to display what we were trying to say or what it meant, I would use that kind of a voice. How did he know I had that kind of a voice? Because when he heard me with Communication Plus, I sang You Got Me Humming like Sam and Dave. I sang Make It Funky like James Brown. I sang So Far Away by Carole King like Johnny Mathis or Nat King Cole. I sang, you know, Lime in the Coconut, you know, like Nelson, but with a little more funk behind it. Just think of Nelson doing Lime in the Coconut with Chuck Rainey playing bass. Hello. You have to look at it with that perspective. He knew what we would do, and he also knew that there were things we could do that he had not touched upon yet. So he had no fear when in his compositions and when he composed a song and he built it around one individual. He also composed the parts for the other individuals in the band, which would be natural for them. Redonzo, that's Ruth Underwood. That's 150% Ruth Underwood. Ruth Underwood is Redonzo. I mean, that is an explanation, and that is a demonstration of who she is and some of the things that she can do. And that doesn't even do all the things. It doesn't even provide material within the song for all the things that she can do. But it is a statement about who Ruth Underwood is. And so he gave us all that respect. He didn't say, okay, I wrote this and you have to adapt to it. He says, here's the song, I want you to do it, and you interpret it, because you can do that with this song. I know that.
Right.
I know you. I mean, you know, this is, and when we did The Evil Prince, for example, he called me back, he says, hey, I've done this Broadway show called Thingfish, he says, and I wrote a part in there for The Evil Prince. Now, how did he get the idea to write a part in there for a guy named The Evil Prince? Because when we were doing The Torture Never Stops on the 77 tour with Terry Bozzio, Roy Estrada, Andre Lewis, and Frank and myself, when we did The Torture Never Stops, he allowed me to go and get as many costumes and dress changes that I wanted. And I got one for every song. I would wear these white tights, these gymnastic tights, and then I would get all these different jackets and little masks and hats and everything. And each song, I would put on clothes to interpret what that song was about. Well, when he did The Torture Never Stops, I created this part of this guy, because The Torture Never Stops, it's about this guy who works for the government, and he's in this laboratory, and he's making this making up this stuff called glucolodna, and he's got all these people in the dungeon that he's testing it on and everything, you know, and they're locked away. And so this guy has to be something like an evil prince, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
When he speaks, he has to have, like, this fake opera voice, no, you know, and stuff like that. And so he says, hey, I wrote this part called Evil Prince. He says, and I need you to come down and record it on the album. I said, sure. So I came down there, and we did a bunch of other stuff on You Are What You Is, but we were mostly doing the Thingfish. And I even did on the Thingfish album, I used, at that time, I was singing like harmony. I was singing like these, I could sing two or three voices at one time. But I stopped doing it because it hurt my throat, you know, and my voice is too... It's too important to, you know, just to use to create that gimmick. It was a gimmick, and I could do it, but it was damaging to my throat. But the most important thing is that after we all finished, he sent everybody home, and him and I went into his other studio where he had the grand piano, and he had some words, and he put the words up there, and we did this all the time. He says, "You brought your tape recorder, right?" And because this is something that happened with him and I all the time. He would go in there and he'd have the words. He'd sit down at the piano and he would try, he would look at the words, and he'd try to figure out a melody for the words. Dun, 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 no, no, no. Dun, 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 no, no, no. He says, okay, that's it. He says, okay. He says, sing this with that line. Somewhere over there. He said, okay, now tape it. And then I would tape it on my tape recorder and then put it on pause. And he's okay, I'll get the next line. And we went through that whole song like that. I still have the cassette. He did it one line at a time. Then I would take the cassette, get back in my car, drive to San Jose. All the way down there, I'm listening to this. And I practice it while I'm there. And then on Monday, I come back. I listen to it all the way down for 6 hours. And then I go in the studio and record it. And that's how it was done.
Talk, if you would, this is tremendous tremendous insight. Talk, if you would, just about the ability of bringing up the radio DJ or the audience participation, the women, you know, getting people involved and doing it in like a playful way. Because, you know, it seems, you know, when I spoke to Tom Fowler, I mean, Tom was just very evident. I mean, he's a gifted musician, but he's like, I was 21 years old. I didn't know what to say to Frank. I didn't know how to have a, you know, I didn't know what kind of conversations to have with the guy. I know I'd feel the same way. It seems like you and him had a much, you were able to relate on many different levels. But I wonder, you know, with him just taking sort of the people off the street mentality, that is a very trusting kind of thing at that time.
Yes, it was. But the thing about it is that we were in total control of what happened, how it happened, when it started, and when it ended. For example, I'll give you an example. He and George and I wrote a song that hasn't been released yet, but I'm going to try and release it one day, and it's called The Velvet Sunrise, okay? Now, you wonder, what is the... Now, we used to have, before we sang the song, or halfway through the song, we would have three girls come up on the stage, okay? And they had to have Levi's on, or jeans. And we would have them lay down on the stage on their backs, okay? Straight. And he would get on one side, and I would get on the other side, and we'd have a contest who had the better or the higher or the most the most extreme velvet sunrise. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And so what we were, and they didn't know what we were looking at, and we were cracking up, and the audience was just having so much fun watching us having fun and laughing, and we're singing about this thing. And this one particular day, this was at a college, and so we're looking at. We're looking at them, and so, okay, then we fight. We got a winner. They, to the day, don't know why they won. This girl doesn't know why she won the contest. But we would get down and look at them, and we would see who had whose vagina protruded the most. Okay? And you can see that with jeans on. Whichever vagina protruded highest, that was the winner. And the vagina is what the velvet sunrise is. Now, that's musician inside jokes, inside stuff, okay?
Oh, that's great. That's why
nobody knows it except the musicians. We would sing about it. I would sing about it. I made up these words all the time, and I'd sing about it, and George would be playing like, I mean, that kind of music. The velvet sunrise. I mean, it was incredible. I mean, and Frank loved it because on down the road, each month or each week or each experience, we would have to explain to Frank what these things meant, like what a booger bear is, okay? He never knew what a booger bear was, you know, until we explained it to him, because that's all inside ghetto stuff, you know what I'm saying? It's from our culture. Stuff like that. Oh, she's a booger, man. He says, a booger? What? I mean, yeah. But every time we would explain stuff to him like that, he would incorporate it into the show and into the material that he composed.
You know, it's incredible. I'm being physically, mentally outlasted by Napoleon Murphy Brog right now. This is unbelievable. You know, I wanted to play a piece of music here, not an offshoot, but a collaboration with a dear friend of yours, and we'll come back and you can walk us through it, okay?
Sure.
Think of any better place to be than in that studio with just beautiful women, octaves, and just singing about taking some chances, you know?
Listen, let me tell you something. I love George Duke. George Duke is one of the greatest humanitarians, one of the greatest people, one of the greatest musicians that I've ever known in this life and my other lives that I'm aware of. George Duke, we had a little chemistry.
Mm-hmm. A little.
Yeah. George would say, "Okay, Nappy, here's your lines," and I said, "Okay, what's the melody?" He says, "No, you make up the melody. you know what to do. You know what to do. I know you know, and you know. Just do what you do." And he used to always, if you notice on all those albums where we sing harmony parts like that and everything, and he takes a solo, you'll notice that each time after the other women, they might sing their parts before, you know, singularly, but he would always have me sing mine after his solo, okay? Because he knows that I know that after the keyboard solo, you have to take it up another level. You have to take it up another level. Each time a verse comes by, it should go up. It should, you know, especially when you get to the solo. After that, it should go leaps and bounds. And he knew that I would take those words and I would interpret them with a melody line that is going to interpret them to where you feel it. You know it, that what I'm saying is true, and you experience it, you know, for the first time, but you want to experience it over and over again. That, I mean, I was so honored by Frank and George. I mean, I would have done it for free. Because the thing about it is that the honor that they gave me, the way they, the respect that they gave me and my ability to interpret their lyrics, you know, while the track was playing, was such an honor that I have never, I still haven't overcome, you know, the intensity of it this time in my life. This is why I work my ass off right now to be as good but better than I was then. And I am. And if you come and see me live, you'll know that. You won't see 30 or 40 year gap between the time I recorded that music and the way I can perform that music today. And I have been on a mission for the last 30 years to make sure that that happened. Because, and that's out of my respect for what they allowed me to do with their compositions. I want everyone to know, every time you see me and hear me, that they didn't make a mistake when they chose me. They knew exactly what they were doing, and it happened.
You know, I mean, it comes down to the fact that that they gave you complete trust, and whether it's marriage, being in a band, or just being a teacher, that's the ultimate allowing you to put your own accent on things that they might have had a part in as well. But I ask you now, when you go around playing, I mean, do you find that people are still able to take it up another level? I like what you said about George after his keyboard solo. He knew you had to go up one more level. Are people still taking it up to that level, or can they just go to a certain level and some engineer can say, oh, yeah, it's okay, we'll fix it?
And this is what's happening today because of technology, you see. Back then, we didn't have this type of technology where you could do that. You see, back then, you either had it or you didn't.
Right, exactly.
You either had it or you didn't, and fortunately for me, I was blessed, and I thank God every day before I eat any meal, three times a day, I will thank God for my blessings. And let me tell you, I was gifted and blessed, and I had it. And I it blows me away, but it doesn't, because it's a process of giving. And when you give, guess what happens? Unselfishly, you receive in abundance. It's automatic.
You know, and I need these. I need these sermons for my own life. But I would be remiss in our remaining minutes here. I have a couple of friends who are huge Napoleon Murphy Brock fans, and they. Could you give us some juicy inside details about balls? Can you talk about if the music, I have some friends that just wrote me litanies of questions, but I was like, you know, I'm not going to spend the entire time on that, but you know, let's throw them a bone a little bit. Why don't you, you know what to do.
Ask me the question.
Well, I mean, I think what one of the questions was, you know, when was all the material put together? Was it around the same time, or was it taken from different years? And how did that all work out?
It was most of that material was written after I left Frank, and then after I wasn't with George anymore, because I left Frank in 77, and I put together another band called Gregarious Movement, which was five musicians that were doing basically the same thing that Communication Plus did. I mean, that was keeping me in touch with the rest of the with the music in the rest of the world, other than Zappa or Duke that I was doing. Okay, now it was written during 78 and 79, and then when I went with George in 80 until 81 and almost into 82, I wrote the rest of it after that. But I had to wait until technology caught up to itself to where I could release it, where I didn't have to have a recording contract. You understand?
I see. Okay. So you were, the amount of money they were going to charge for you to actually put it together at the time, you had to wait for it, you could do it yourself.
So I could do it myself, and I knew the technology, and everything would change. You know, I mean, I was a sophomore in high school, and I took typing. I could type over 40 words a minute. I was the only male person in the typing class. Why? Because I knew it was significant for the future. I saw this nurse that my mom used to work for, this family called Dr. and Mrs. Carey, and he was a doctor, and she was her nurse. His wife was his nurse, and I was in his office one time, and I saw her looking at this piece of paper, and not looking at what her fingers were doing on this typewriter, and I'm going like, damn. Wow, that's magical. You mean you look with your eyes at these words, they're transferred through your brain all the way down your arms into your fingers on these keys, and your fingers know which key to hit. I said, damn. So I took typing. That was 52 girls. There were 53 people in the class, 52 girls and me. And I thought I was in the wrong class. She says, no, guys don't take typing. I said, well, they're dumb, because this is magic, okay? So here's the deal for balls. You know, I had to put out balls first, get that out there, because that was the material of original compositions that said who I was and what I felt. Like, for instance, on balls, there's a song called Let Me Still Be Me. Now, if you listen to the lyrics and you read the lyrics on there, you're going to identify with that. It says, I don't know you like I know myself, but in time, you know, we'll find out what you need to, read them. Read the lyrics and balls, and you will identify with them. Hi, Mom, I love you. You know, it takes more to be parents than just having babies. Just having babies don't make good parents. If you hadn't been there then, I wouldn't be here now, and therefore, hi, Mom, I love you. I wouldn't do anything that would hurt you. That's about your mother. That's about his mother. That's about her mother. That's about everybody's mother, because that's just the truth. The truth is absolute. It just is, okay? Now, I wrote my first classical piece of music there called Patience. I was doing weekend gigs and everything, and one morning I didn't feel like driving all the way home, so I stopped at my dad's house, and I stayed with him, and I got up the next morning, and I was looking out the window having coffee at the mountains in San Jose, and I said, wow, God, you know, I've done all this with Frank, I've done all this with George, I've done these bands and everything. When is it going to be my time? When is it going to be my time, God? And he said, and the voice said to me, and I hear the voice because the voice is there. A lot of people don't listen to it. But I hear the voice, and I listen to it, and I follow the voice. And the voice said, be patient. And then this music came in my head. And I couldn't, it just overcame me. So I sat down at my dad's piano. He had one of those little Yamaha baby grands. I sat down there for 2 hours until this song was completed, and I put it on tape, and I went and listened to it, and I went like, oh my God, where did that come from? Later on, I realized that I was just, you know, like, chosen to bring it to this surface, to this level of our reality, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I've had it arranged for orchestra. The Metropole Orchestra of Amsterdam, Holland have played it 3 times, okay? It was debuted in Umeå, Sweden, with chamber music orchestras there. I've gotten countless requests to put it on classical releases and stuff like that. I mean, but I'm not a piano player, but that's me playing Patience on my CD, because it's very, and each one of these conductors that have played it when I was there for the debuts, they were saying, well, I'm having problems with this. And I said, well, listen, here's the problem you're having. You know, it's interpretation. You have to understand that this song was created to interpret a feeling. I said, now what you have to do is understand, and as a conductor, you tell them you can extend a chord or a note, and you tell them where to cut it off. Even though it's longer than what's written on the piece of paper, on the chart, I says, because what you have to visualize is on a semi-windy day in autumn, you see this leaf come off the top of a tree, and it's floating in the atmosphere. And the wind that's blowing causes it to go different ways and everything. But you're watching this leaf that came from the top of a tree, and you're watching it during its travel to the ground, okay? Well, that's what patience is all about. You have to be patient and watch it, you know, on its journey from the top of the tree with the air, with the wind blowing it, until it hits the ground. And that's what's called patience. And I explained that to each of the conductors. I said, so what you want to do, I said, that doesn't have a time signature basically. There's time signatures for certain parts. I says, but from when you stop and when you start the next section, I says, you have to feel that. But the way you feel it is to think about a leaf floating through the atmosphere. And you have to be patient until it hits ground naturally. That's what the song is all about.
Multisensory experiences, are pivotal. And Napoleon, I wanted to say thank you so much for taking the time, because your enthusiasm is so important, and your love and your belief. And I think it's I believe in And a lot of the things you said today, and when I go back and listen to them, those are values more than anything else that need to be passed on to future generations like my daughters. I was born in 1978, well after you started your career. And it's an honor to be able to talk to people who have seen have gone through their own transformations, have not really forgotten, you know, the values that were instilled in them from their role models and the people that gave them opportunities to be successful. So, you know, this will live on forever, and I really appreciate you taking the time.
It's my pleasure. And the thing about it is that something I understood, I understand now. And I've understood, because before I started music, I used to be a behavior modification counselor for about 7-8 years before I started playing music. I worked with mentally retarded, emotionally disturbed children, children who are autistic, brain damaged, cerebral palsy, blind, you know, crippled, whatever. I worked for the San Francisco Recreation Center for the Handicapped. I worked for Job Corps. I worked for Rancho Linda School for the mentally retarded. This is what I did, okay? Because I needed to have an understanding about what it was all about and what values that we should, you know, pass on. And you must share these things with younger generations, because times have changed so much that they might not ever get to experience this kind of stuff because of the evolution of everything that has taken place. I mean, when I did that, when I met Frank in 1973, we didn't have remote controls on televisions. I mean, we had to get up and go manually turn the TV off or change the channel.
Right.
Okay? So just looking at that now, and you see the things that technology has created now that, you know, that I mean, I don't text because I think it makes you lazy. Because the next thing you start just saying, instead of going and writing Y-O-U, you just write you. You know?
No, I mean, and that's...
You know what I'm saying?
No, but I mean, what I love is that it's not about... you know, there you can go after you know, culture, but what I just love is the idea of that, you know, you were in it to win it from the minute you... Wow, I just rhymed there. You were in it to win it from minute one, and you know, you followed your dreams, and you never quit, and you don't quit to this day. And I look forward to coming to see you in person live and seeing that energy, and there's no gap there. You were on a spiritual path, as the other musicians that I've talked to as well. So keep it happening, brother, and we'll link up soon.
We were in the rhythm room just a couple of months ago
in Phoenix. In Phoenix?
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
No, we were at the rhythm
room. That's one of my favorite places.
I know. And we'll be back there again in June and July. We're going to do another American tour. We'll be back in Arizona there too.
I'll come up and see you then.
You should. And I'm getting ready to, and I do a lot of extra stuff too. Like on the 3rd and the 4th of January, I'll be performing, because I perform with these guys all the time, Ed Palermo, Big Band Jazz, and he'll be doing Big Band Zappa. I'll be doing 4 shows at the Iridium in Manhattan.
Oh my, and what are the dates of those?
The dates is January 3rd and 4th, 2 shows a night. I just finished doing 4 shows there in October. October was the 18th and 19th.
At the Iridium.
The Iridium.
You're positive that January 3rd, you're replaying at the Iridium.
I got my ticket in my room.
I'll be performing there. I'll see you there.
That's the only band that I perform with where I do the Evil Prince and the Muffin Man.
Yes.
In full costume.
It's all meant to be.
And listen, I mean, it's like that was my other wish in life, was to play or sing with a band like Stan Kenton or Duke Ellington or Count Basie, and here jumps up Ed Palermo, who is I'm one of his idols. So he composed he arranged all this music, and I'm telling you, you have never heard anything like this. If you haven't heard him and me together, you are in for a treat, Jim.
You better believe it, brother.
January 3rd and 4th, 2 shows. It should be up now. If you go to the iridiumnewyork.com,
wow,
you should see the advertisement on. They might even have some old clipping, some old video on there too.
Yeah, you know what? No, this is great. I just want to tell you this story, and then we got to jam out. But I got to tell you, I told my dad, Todd Barkin, who used to own the Keystone Corner back in Berkeley.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. Barkin is starting a quartet. Harold Mayburn. He's getting a Wednesday night slot. I told my dad, I'm serious, reserve 3 tickets for January 2nd for that show. Now you're coming in the 3rd. So I'm going to call back and say, you know what? Let's reserve 3 tickets for the Iridium on the 3rd for the Ed Palermo Big Band. That's unbelievable. I cannot believe. And then we fly out the 4th. So I'll see you the 3rd, Napoleon.
Hey, listen, Jake. I look forward to meeting you. Come up and say hi and watch what we do.
I mean, now, we're going to take some pictures, dude. I want some pictures with Napoleon, dude.
This is over-the-top stuff, dude. I'm telling you.
All right, man. We'll talk to you soon.
God bless you, my brother. Thank you very much for having me on. And, hey. Remember, I love George Duke, man, and I love Frank Zappa, and they loved me. We were buddies. Frank and I were really, really good buddies. We were friends. We were brothers. And the 3 of us together, it was just magical.
Yeah, you rocked it today, brother. Talk to you soon. All right. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. We'll see you all in a little bit.